Ladies and gentlepongs, varlets and philistines, thieves and vagabonds, potholes and guests, for what you are about to receive, we truly apologize. It should not happen to a dog.
Got in with the Blounds decorators but set to get an apprenticeship, and they sent me to the George Hotel on the Morecambe Promenade and said, report to this bloke there, you know, and he'll teach you how the job. Of course, I get there and it's Mr. Ayres, Jim Ayres. So I didn't know him from Adam, like, you know. Well, of course, I started with the Morecambe Rock and Pop Club a couple of years later, caving, and I never even met Jim until I joined the Red Rose, and Jim's there in charge of everything.
My name's Bill Holden. I would term a lifelong member of the Red Rose Cave and Pothole Club. And my association with Jim goes back to, way back to 1963. So Eccles and I had been up to the lakes, we'd got back into Lancaster, and we'd walked up to the Moulins Hotel, and we stood there for quite a while, sort of plucking up enough courage to actually go in and just see where the Red Rose were. We'd heard that they met in a room at the back of the pub. And I remember we went and opened the door, and the first thing I remember seeing was this guy sort of sat in the corner on a chair with his feet on a bench that went round the room. And we sort of introduced ourselves, and this guy says, come on, well, no problem, come on in, lads. And that was Jim. And that was the first time that we actually met.
My friend Max was quite interested in caving, we wanted to meet up with the cavers, so we were told that all the cavers met on a Friday night at the Moulins Hotel in Lancaster. So following Friday, off we went up to the Moulins Hotel, and that's, I think, is where I met Jim for the first time.
So how old were you?
I would be 15.
You took us on the back of the bikes, the pair of you.
Yeah.
We went round to Alan Potts. And we weren't told that we needed to take a change of clothes, otherwise we were going to get wet through. So we went into Dolly Tubs, and I remember that pitch down to the ledge,
yeah.
Going down there, and then trying to come up and getting me not be able to get my feet back in the ladders, and you were holding. Oh, you're all right. Come on. And then we actually went into Borin's Moor Cave, and there we got royally wet there because we were crawling, you know.
Well, when he first started, he couldn't actually, because he'd ridden a motorbike, he could not actually drive a car without having a competent driver. So. Along came Mel, who passed his test at 17 and was the thinnest, puniest 14-year-old looking person, sat next to a man with Popeye arms driving the car, and you kept thinking, this is wrong. Now, to get in the car and to go up to Ingleton, you had to pay half a crown. Everybody in there, had to pay half a crown, didn't we?
Yeah. You didn't get a lift unless you brought your half a crown.
Yeah, it was like clink, half a crown as soon as you got in. But
it was to pay for the petrol.
It was, yes, of course. But I might just say, if we hadn't done that, we wouldn't have gone caving.
The BSA leased the land from the owner and put a locked lid on the entrance. Only trips authorised by Mr. Eli Simpson, who ran the BSA, were allowed in. And these privileged few were coming back each week with tales of more and more wonders that they had found. It was about this time that Mr. Simpson realised that this cave was going further than he'd expected and towards the higher reaches of East Gill, where there are numerous sinks of the stream but little known cave. And the row that ensued resulted in a big breakup of the BSA, and two new clubs were formed, the Northern Pennine with George Dr. Aspin, with his trademark USA tin helmet from the war, and Arthur Gemmell, and many others. The other group, founded by Wolf Taylor, was the Red Rose Cave and Pothole Club with Jim Ayres.
I have a couple of Land Rovers and a trailer kept next door to the pub at Clapham.
By the late 60s, Jim Newton, Jim Ayres and other Red Rose members were on the Cave Rescue Organisation call-out lists. Jack Sheldon joined the Red Rose in 1970, but 2 years later, while at Lancaster University and caving with the University Cavers, he would become involved in a rescue that would involve both Jim Newton and Jim Ayres. The Lancaster University Cavers had been exploring the recently discovered Foul Country extension in Gaping Gill, which was entered by the notorious Blowhole.
We made our way to a place called India Chamber at the far end of the Far Country, and spent several hours digging in a very awkward and loose rift. Anyway, we eventually decided to go out and made our way along the low passages until we came to what was meant to be the dock in Southgate, only to find that the entire passage was flooded to the roof.
After waiting several hours, hoping that the water level would lower, they resorted to digging away at the gravel, hoping that they might lower it enough to escape.
Anyway, eventually, after some time, there was a sort of gloopy noise which suggested to me that the sump was opening up, so I pushed along Southgate, a fairly epic dock, because there was very little airspace, and I got to Echo Rift, climbed the ladder, and made my way to the blowhole. And listening on this side, I could hear on the home side, Jim Newton and Jim Ayre having a little conversation. And one Jim was saying to the other, it's a bit bloody tight there, let's just wait where we are for a couple of these young, slim ones to come along. Anyway, I pushed on through the blowhole, and there was a great reunion. Nice to see them both. And after over 30 hours down the cave, I was quite pleased when they gave me a chocolate wafer biscuit.
So did you do Giant's Hole?
Yes, we did, yep. Didn't we?
Yep, following morning.
Yep, there we were. Jim led us down and we started. In them days, you had to bail along canal, and we brought the buckets. But there were buckets there, but we had buckets as well. And we all took it in turns to bail, didn't we?
Yep.
We and then once it had lowered, we could crawl along and go to the next part of the cave, which is called the Crab Walk. Now, John Franklin, as he worked, as training as a doctor, worked in Manchester and was able to get the day off, and he was the one person that joined our camping group. And he was in front of me, which was a mistake, because Jim led the way and he was obviously a slim person. That's John Franklin, just jammed in all of this crab walk and sweat. And I think it was obviously a good thing, a workout for him, because I can remember the sweat running down his face as he tried to get through this crab walk. Of course, the slower we went through the crab walk, the water was filling up behind us. So consequently, I don't think we got as far into Giant's Hole as what we hoped for, because Jim was the timer, and Jim was saying, we must return. And sure enough, I mean, in the first one through, must have gone through with probably the head up against the ceiling to get through, and bailing it for us,
oh my
for
goodness.
The rest of us. So we all went through in different
sort of like levels of water. So the next one came through and it was probably the chin was up, and the next person came through and a little bit more, the shoulders were up.
So was Jim the last, as he'd been the leader? Or did he lead out to make sure he was...
I think we sent Jim first.
Jim had got a grant from the... I think it was the Daily Express or something. And he printed all this bump about biggest shaft in the world and all this. And they went. He went out with Kelly the year before, and it was such a... Well, a right farce it was, but we'd been to Fayoum in France, and the French showed us their little mangle that they'd made with Dexian tubing with 1,000 foot of wire on. And it was great, 300 foot pitch, you know, no trouble at all. Two blokes kept winding it like a mangle, and you came up beautifully, you see. So Jim Oxfam in the Happy Wanderers made one of these winches, and we took that out with us. And I don't know, I remember they went down at 650 foot, we landed on a big snow ledge. The next bit was, as you went down, the ladder sunk into the snow. And the lifeline, well, it was just a waste of time, because if he'd have gone below the snow ledge, it would have sunk into the snow and he wouldn't have been able to get back up again, you know. He went down as far as he could, like, and didn't... He said, I don't think we had enough ladder, because it went a lot deeper than he'd ever thought, like, if I'd had another 700 foot, I believe, you know. But I always remember coming up that ladder, you know, with two men winching it, you were running, like, because we'd trained, like, second 200 foot, great, still going like a bomb. The third 200 foot, it was up against the wall, and you couldn't get your feet in fast enough, you see. So I'm giving it some sticks, shouting, slow down, you boobies, you know, and all this. And there's Rose up there at the top, our cook, and she said, there's ladies up here, you know. And I said, well, get away from the bloody hole, you know. And she, there's no breakfast for you tomorrow morning, you know. Went to Preston Corporation, and we bought a bus for 110 quid or something, you know.
I think I can't remember now, but did we have it at Green Cross for about a week, because we quite a bit of work to do.
That's right. Yeah.
It's because we put another tank in, didn't we? Put another extra fuel tank in.
Oh yeah, that's right.
Yeah. And when we did that, you did the painting on the side of the bus. Looking for adventure in whatever comes our way. We had to change. We got to the wrong boat and we wouldn't fit on the boat, so we had to drive down the bloody coast and wait somewhere else.
Yeah.
And eventually ended up getting across. Looking for adventure in whatever comes our way. Come all the way through Belgium on the motorway, and the Germans decided that we were something like 6 inches too bloody tall.
Well, only flatten it. You know, just take it off to the level, like, you know.
Top of the windows, yeah.
Well, little Trevor, who was a joiner, Trevor Dearden, he nipped over the fence. They were building huts at the back of the Arkan thing, and he came back with strips of wood and things like, and he knew what he was doing, like, and we lowered the bus by, we got it down to 13 foot 6, we took 2 foot off. Looking for
adventure in whatever comes our way. You've been caving in Austria, haven't you?
Yeah.
And you've been explaining where everything was, and then we were coming down that massive pass, and we didn't realise at the time, we kept going faster and faster, and we lost vacuum on the bloody brakes.
Yeah, that's right.
And we didn't know, got to the bottom of the bloody pass, and we had no vacuum on the brakes. I think it was Dave Butts and somebody else. They must have gone for a bit of a walk, and they pulled up to this encampment where they were like Afghan gypsies. And they got offered whether they wanted to buy a little boy or a little girl.
Yeah.
you know, and we could, they were offering us all drugs and stuff like that as well. But... Remember the pass, don't you? The Tengaroo pass.
Yeah.
I mean, that was really spectacular, was that?
And I was shouting at him, pull up, I want a picture, you know?
Yeah, that really was spectacular. Because they don't have this idea as to who, which side of the road do you drive on. They just drive where they want, and there were people, you know, there were people going off into the ditch, and then, well, when I say ditch, it was about a 1,000-foot ditch. When we came off the heat of Afghanistan, which was really, really hot, I mean, well over sort of 100 degrees Fahrenheit, and then we dropped into Pakistan, and the humidity, the temperature dropped to about 90 Fahrenheit. The humidity, was, you know, you're just dripping with water. Looking for adventure in whatever comes our way. And then it was pretty well, more or less, easy going until we got to the real big hills going up into up to Simla, and it was beautiful then. The drive to Simla was absolutely beautiful. Do you remember much about Simla when we first arrived there?
Well, only the view, it was so green and brass, you know, it's smashing, and just keep on going, you know.
Yeah. And then we got to Arki, where it was as far as we could actually go, where we were going to set up camp. And I think if I remember rightly, while Rod and I were going to see the magistrates and the thing, you went and wandered off to the cave.
We didn't really have much luck with the caves because they were all quite young there, you know.
And, you know, the caving wasn't brilliant, but we were still getting quite a lot of caves, because I think we ended up surveying about 10 or 15 caves.
And one day we were up there, and it was a shake hole. I couldn't believe it. I'd never seen one out there, you know. Bingo! There's this shake hole with a hole in the bottom. Well, I thought, home and dry. And as we went down the first pitch, there's this rushing sound. We thought, water. Oh, we're really home and dry here. But no, it was bats coming out.
We had to leave because we were only allowed to stay there for 3 months. We were coming to work, and there were still people coming in telling us about caves.
It was December, and we thought, well, we hope we get back before it freezes, like, sort of thing. We set off back to Pakistan, got to Iran. We had to go over a couple of big passes there, and it was all snow, you know, and I mean, the temperature was minus 30.
We were going up to Damavan, and then the roads started to ice up, and then the linking water pump went, and with bloody flames coming out of the back of the bus. And then we had to put caving ropes around the tyres so that we could get some grip. And we parked up, and we ended up, I don't know, it was really, really cold. We must have been about 8,000 feet. And you could see the big peak where Noah had parked his boat. And it was really, really, really cold. And eventually the block cracked. And eventually we ended up having to leave the bus, which was quite sad.
Mm.
And then we had a 3-day journey back on the train.
Some of my first memories of Jim, I remember being invited on caving trips, thinking, yeah, this is great. I'll go along and see what this is all about. Taking down Bull Pot of the Witches. Few questions going around, is there anyone small enough to go through this small hole, have a look around? Yep, there's this little kid here, he's small enough, he can go through. So suddenly realised the reason I was really there. Fortunately, these ledges were much higher than I could reach, so I was having to be lifted up, hold by my legs and poked through these holes to see if there went anywhere, and Jim would be questioning, oh, can you see anything? What's through there? Could you find anything? Unfortunately, we didn't, but I definitely did my best shot at it.
The Pyrenees, 1980, or was it 79, something around there. And we went out 2 minute buses to the Pyrenees. So Jim insisted on going up this track into this wood to find the campsite. It was dark, there'd been a thunderstorm, it was wet, it was miserable. Eventually, we got up there. And we camped a few nights up there, and then we lit this big bonfire one night, and Jim had gone to bed with Jackie, and somebody decided to throw a gas canister on the fire. And a minute later, this gas canister exploded. This mushroom ball of flame went up through these trees and lit the whole place up. And Jim, there was this enormous scream from Jim's tent, which was Jackie. And Jim came flying out of the tent. You silly bastards, what do you think you're doing?
I can go back to my very first trip, which was 15th of August 1971. You know, Jim was the Red Rose at the time. He was the hard kingpin, so to speak. He's the one that you looked up to. Caving with him was really good. You know, he was a strong individual. He sort of led the teams. You know, he led the big trips.
Most of the club went down Allen, the classical route. A few went down Dickon, and those that came down Dickon said, well, we're never going in there again. So they looked like drowned rats. But because they laddered it, somebody had to go out. So you said, yeah, I'll do it. We'll go out that way. So, and it was like vertical swimming, wasn't it? Because they laddered it all straight in the water. And we could half climb, half swimming. So I don't know how you managed to get up. If you say you can't swim, you must have swung up those ladders. And on the last pitch, I remember, I came up and I saw you were sitting in the water to shake me from the spray while I was climbing it. Just to reduce the intensity on that last climb. And as soon as you stood up, a massive wall of water came over the pitch. Yeah. And we got out and so what do you think of that, Jim? Yeah, all right, bit of fun that, bit damp.
There was far too many of us. There was at least three or four, might have been four in the back seat because I was like squashed sideways, you know. I thought, I've got all the way to Mendips to go like this, you know. And then way down on the M6 somewhere, there was a big bang, and your tyre had burst, and you pulled in, very quickly got the wheel changed, and said, we're not going to get to Mendips in time for this, but I've got a plan. We went to somewhere over, you got into a red telephone box, and you rang John Franklin, who I think he was still at university doing his medical thing. And we all kicked on the floor, which was highly uncomfortable. but we went down Swildens and a few other bits. And we got lost trying to find Blue Pencil Passage to go over the sub. But I think it's because it was genuinely very tight.
He was famous for changing his car so often. You know, he had the Vauxhall Estate, he had the Jag, he had the Saab two-stroke, and we had some really strange drives. Because if you remember, Jim's got the glass eye, yeah. And so when he had to overtake, because it was his right eye, he had to use to come out more than most of us had to, so he'd go out into the middle of the road and then he'd suddenly drive it back in again. And I tell you what, driving with Jim was more dangerous than caving, let me say that.
After I'd sort of got into the way of things in the Red Rose, and like, I deferred to the people who knew where the best bits of cave, well, death places to look for new cave were, you see. And I remember thinking, well, this guy, he's pretty keen on sort of going places, this Jim Newton guy. He looks tough, he is tough, and I'll follow him because he's probably got a, you know, I think he's probably going to be right. So, one day I pitched up at the farm without actually knowing sort of, you know, what was on at the weekend. And it appeared that we were all going into Lancaster Hole to have a look at this small passage that you said issued a stream. And it was somewhere up, about halfway up the Lancaster Hole streamway towards Eureka Junction. Oh, well, that sounds fun. I'm up for that. I'll go along on that. So we all got ready, put our kit on. I think it was actually quite late on a Saturday. We didn't actually sort of almost go down until the evening. But Vernon Huntworth was there. I think Boz was there. Pete Llewellyn was there. And there were about sort of, you know, eight or nine people on this trip. With all the ladder paraphernalia, having to go down Lancaster Hole and everything like that. And dressed in tatty old wetsuits and fertiliser bags to, you know. Anyway, you dived in. No. I think you were following someone else. I think it was maybe Vernon went up, because after all, it was your lead. It was your find. But we hadn't gone that far when there was a terrible sort of thrashing and, you know, cursing and swearing and... How did you get up there? So I can't get round the corner. And there was all this sort of like, and we were thinking, well, is he stuck? And we're going to have to go and pull him out. What's he going for? And eventually you came back down out of the entrance to the passage. A bit upset by the fact that you haven't been able to follow the skinny in front.
Yeah.
And giving it plenty of verbals. But you started to have a look around elsewhere, thinking, well, maybe there's another way into this thing. And a couple of you went off to have a look up this sandy slope and into a small chamber that might have gone over the top. And the rest of us, I remember I piled in, Pete Llewellyn piled in, someone else piled in, and we all shot off up this this passage. And it looked like it was going, but in the distance, behind us, we could hear this voice sort of saying, "Come back! What are you doing? Come back!" So eventually we came back because we thought, well, we can't bag it all. You know, we've got to leave something to do. So you were in a sort of situation of high excitement because your dig had gone, your lead had gone. But also highly pissed off that you weren't able to get into it.
Yeah, Jim was a great character. He was never short of a few words, and I always remember if by any chance you got hold of his mug in the kitchen, you were dead. You were dead. Whether, you know, that was Jim's mug. Sense of humour.
Yeah.
And Jim got a sense of humour. Club. There was a lot of piss taking. It was non-stop. Yeah, I mean, you got the piss taken out of you, something rotten. But then, you know, people still respected you.
From Lancaster Hall to County Pothole, Wretched Rabbit. And we're all at the entrance, and Jim goes down, and then Jess heads off. "We'll head off, we'll be a bit slower." And someone said, "Is that wise?" "Aye." "Well, between them, they've got three good eyes and two good legs."
When I used to come up here caving, he once chased us all over the fell. Because we didn't have a permit. And we went down this hole, and I think it was both part of summer. I can't remember what it was, but we went down summer. And he stood at top, and he says, "I'll turn a blind eye to it this time." And that's exactly what he said.
Right, well, in the latter days of the Doghole excavation, Jim had heard that they'd found a horse burial, so every expert from the round the area came because they thought it would have Iron Age, didn't it?
Yeah.
And so Jim had heard about it as well, and he'd been involved, so there were no stopping him. He piled down the ladder and through the climbing and gets his camera out and then comes back up just as fast. So I mean, that's must have been 80 then.
It was Jim who put us onto it in the first place, which You and your mate, weren't you? You were pulling bones out.
Yeah.
From it. Yeah. Lionel. Human bones. Lionel, that's it, yeah.
Hi Jim, it's John Conway. Just to say hello and to thank you very much indeed for all those wonderful memories that we had many years ago while we were caving in the Himalayas and also the trip we went to in France. You're a wonderful guy, Jim. Thank you very much indeed.
And here's to you, Jim Newton, my longtime friend.
Hi Jim, we've had some great times over the past few years, working on your book, shooting video and undertaking some very serious armchair caving. You're always good company, Jim. I look forward to many more chats together, trips to the farm and cake.
Hi Jim, you are already a caving legend, but I also recall our climbing visits to Scotland and Austria in your Jaguar car. It is moments like this which make life memorable for us all.
Why, Jim, we're both real old buggers now, aren't we? And, you know, you've been part of the caving world for as long as I remember. And that's at least a week. And, you know, we've had such incredible memories out of it. So, keep it up and enjoy whatever years you've got left. Take care. Cheers, Jim.
Well, Jim, you dragged Mum and I into the caving world in the mid-1970s, and I think we knew pretty quickly our lives were going to be different, especially for Mum. I could have done without your accident, but really grateful to the cave rescuers who got you out. I'm very proud of you and always enjoyed your company. Especially these last few years when we've been going up to Bull Pot Farm together and having fun with all the members of the Red Rose. So we'll keep on doing that.
But we need to kind of start, will you start filming me please? I don't want to.
Oh, well, thank you again, lad.
Yeah, go be soon.
Yeah, yo.
Yeah, yeah. Look at Jim.